Please welcome Britta Glade.
Hello and welcome to the final installment in South Stage Keynote for Wednesday afternoon. On behalf of RSA Conference, I want to say thank you. Thank you for being here this week as part of RSA Conference, and I thank you for being in this session. I think it's going to be a nice treat for all of you. So I always like to know a little bit about my audience. By raise of hands, who out there considers themselves to be a musician? Oh, excellent. Okay, keep your hands up. Additionally, who took the recorder in elementary school? Right? Okay, you know how to make a C sharp, you know how to make a B flat. So I would say we've almost got a good 50% of musicians in the room. Okay, hands down. Another question. This is going to be the sympathy vote. How many of you have had a fourth grader this year, either at home or in your world, who's been learning the recorder? Oh, yeah. Okay. There's going to be some songs that might sound a little bit familiar to you guys, so keep that in mind. So I became very interested in this relationship between music and programming early in my career. I was on a press tour. I was sitting in the lobby of Dr. Dobbs Journal. I was trying to cram, look super smart, so that when I go in with the editor, everything's going to be good. I'm looking at the carousel of magazines, and they were hardcore programming or hardcore music. And it seemed odd to me. It seemed like really different audiences. So when I went into the office, I asked Gwen, who, mind you, there's piles of programming books and there's electric guitars all over the wall. I wondered, is this a personal interest of his, or is there a business reason that they have these types of publications? And he shared with me they had actually over 70% readership crossover between these programming publications and these hardcore musical pubs. The light bulb went on. Music is programming, right? A middle C is a middle C is a middle C. It's always gonna sound like that. Put C, E, G together, you know, C chord's gonna sound that way. Go up a chord, D, F sharp, A, it's gonna sound that way. Combine it with this. There's a scientific, predictable way that music's gonna sound. It's just like programming, right? So, when the submission came through our call for speaker process with a shout out to Chuck Davies. It's Chuck, okay. Chuck is the one who introduced this story to us, and it's an amazing one. So we looked at this, we explored it. It's always gonna, this is an evergreen story. It's an amazing story. You're gonna meet Merryl in a moment. But particularly with the situation that's going on right now in the Ukraine, it became all the more relevant, right? So, RSA community, I have tremendous, tremendous pleasure of introducing you to Dr. Merryl Goldberg. Thank you for being here. Okay, was that the best walk-on music you guys have ever heard? Right? Okay.
Yeah.
We got some energy here. Was that your band?
That was my band.
I didn't know that was actually your band. Okay, we're in for a treat. Okay, we have a room. I would establish 53.5% of our room is musical. So we've got people who know where we're coming from. So they're going to know a little bit about the music that you've written as they look at the sheet music that's in front of us. So, okay. Awesome. Just so you know what you're dealing with in here. Okay. So this would be an interesting story anytime. You're a young woman in your 20s. You decide to go on vacation to the Soviet Union in the mid-80s. Interesting choice. Musical instrument in hand. let me show you this beautiful young woman who goes to... Nice, same smile, same sparkle in the eye. Set the stage for us. How did you find yourself there?
Right, so it was 1985. I was 26 years old, you're absolutely right. I was already a professional musician. I play saxophone, that's a soprano sax. And I play klezmer music, which is Eastern European Yiddish music. And we had the opportunity at the time to go to the Soviet Union to meet with a group of people called the Phantom Orchestra, which was a group of dissidents and people who are called refuseniks, who had asked to leave the Soviet Union. 1985 was a really rough go of it for people who were human rights activists. So dissidents, human rights activists, refuseniks, Helsinki monitors had formed in Tbilisi, Georgia, of all places, a group, a musical group to band together, literally. And people in the West were interested in that. And so I got asked, along with three other musicians from the Klezmer Conservatory Band, if we might go in and meet them and support them and find out what they were doing.
Okay, so I'm a mom of two girls in my 20s who are musical, and there's a situation in Eastern Europe right now. Should I be concerned? How did you prepare yourself? How did your parents feel about this?
We had to prepare pretty much in secret, but it took 4 months of learning more about the Soviet Union, about dissidents, about people. And also, it required us to figure out a way to get in where we weren't being obvious. In other words, we couldn't write down the names of people or their addresses or things about them, because it would put them in jeopardy if at customs they saw that, and it would put us in jeopardy as well. So we, each of us, had to think of a way to come up with a method, either, you know, scribbling in a checkbook or this or that. And so I came up with the code in music.
In music, excellent. Okay. You land in the Soviet Union. Here's a 1974 map. You'll notice it's a little bit shifty from a map. If you were to pull up a map of the of Russia now, with where things are placed, you land in Moscow. What is your first 24 hours like?
Yeah, first 24 hours were crazy. We land in Moscow, and somehow we were tipped. We had been tipped off, and somehow the people at customs had a sense there was something going on, that we weren't
ordinary. With these 20-year-olds on vacation in the Soviet Union in 1985.
Carrying a saxophone.
Or two. You had two, didn't you? Because didn't you bring something in for someone to share?
Yeah, I ultimately gave my saxophone to a young boy, a 12-year-old, in Armenia.
I got it.
Yeah,
okay.
But, you know, so I had a saxophone, Jeff had a guitar, and Rosalie was singing, and Hankus had a keyboard. We land.
You didn't go carry-on.
There was no carry-on there.
Okay, yeah.
And we were, you know, in the line, and the customs agents went through every single thing. And I say this, it's kind of crazy, but they even opened up Tampax containers. I mean, I couldn't believe how they searched us. And then, you know, including, this is the actual music that I brought. I had my music book. They went through every single page, and then they handed it back. I was like, whoa. So anyways, that was, after they did all the searching, we actually were taken into a back room with a very ginormous person who had a very loud voice and banged on the table and started asking us many, 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 many questions. And then we had another person who we nicknamed Kevin, because Kevin comes back in the story. He reminded of us of someone from Somerville, if any of you from Boston. So Kevin, you know, was the good guy. Must be from Boston.
And he knows Kevin.
Yeah, and then the big guy screaming at us. So, and Kevin would translate, what he's asking you is, you know, who are your parents? What are you doing? Blah, blah, blah. We get through all of that. We arrive at the hotel. We're told to be good tourists. And we think, okay, we better keep a low key. Well, first thing that happens to us is some other tourists come running up to us. Aren't you with the Klezmer Conservatory Band?
Oh, no.
So that was just
cover blown.
Cover blown, but it was still kind of fun.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, I want to explore this music, and we're going to put some of the music up so that you can see it. The 50th 3.5%, is that what I declared in the audit? You're gonna recognize some things in the music that look familiar. You're gonna recognize some things that maybe don't look quite as familiar. So I do want to establish going into this, when Merryl and I first met, she made very clear to me, I'm not a cryptographer, but you're a musician. Mm-hmm. A musician with a heart of gold who created your own system of encryption. Just in case you wonder, we're not going to reveal any trade secrets from Merryl as to your encryption, but you know, you'll see some things in the code. But how did you develop it? So on this slide, well, we'll let them decide, side A or side B, if is it real music? Should we do a poll? Who thinks one? Side A, who of you thinks that is real music? Okay? Side B, who of you thinks that's the real music? We have a 50-50 split you're gonna have to break out here for us. So we've got some music in front of us. Tell us what's here.
Yeah, so both are real music. You can play both of them. But the piece that's on the left is an actual tune. And I have it in my notebook, my music manuscript book. And the other, though, is coded. That one, what I did without giving away the whole code is I just assigned certain notes to certain letters. And then I played around with some decoy stuff in terms of the clefs, if you know any of that. And the way I came up with it was, I remember my dad, when I was a little kid, I wanted to take bread out to feed ducks from a restaurant, and I thought, oh, that's stealing. You can't do that. And my dad, who was a real street urchin, he grew up in Chelsea, Massachusetts, if any of you know that, said, oh, the way you do it is you just make believe nothing is wrong. It's like, this is an everyday thing you do. And I thought to myself, I'm bringing in music. Music is an everything day I do. The music would be a great way. And, you know, I kind of intellectually had fun coming up with the code. And like any code, I think, and again, I am not an expert in this, but once you can read the code and you practice it, it becomes kind of easy. You can just
it's yours. It's your language. So your book, you scattered the actual music with not actual music, with Merryl music, with messages throughout. So when you're being searched, they're looking through all of this. Are they judging your music? Are they asking you any questions about your music? How did you sneak it in?
Yeah, not at all. They went through, looked at it, and handed it right back.
Got it.
It really
so hidden in plain
like
sight.
Music.
Hidden in plain sight.
Exactly.
Okay. So you fourth grade recorder Holmes. This one's for you. This is a Merryl original piece. And we could choose, you know, grand piano setting, bass setting, vibe setting, choir setting. How did you visualize this music when you wrote it?
I think piano.
Piano, excellent. Okay, cool. So this is it. It's tricky because it's not 4-4. There's 4-4, there's 2-4, there's 3-4. It kind of all finds its way through, but see if this sounds familiar, fourth grade parents. One.
Voila!
A Merryl original song. You all heard it here first. So someone that knows music, if they're looking at it, going through your stuff, might have questioned your musical choice there.
Maybe. And, you know, it sounds a lot like if you study music, like modern music, you would hear music like this, perhaps. You might not like it. It's a little bit more fun to play than to listen to. But one of the cool things about music and coding, or you know, what I did is people invent notation anyways.
Sure.
So, you know, and they write crazy things. So again, like you said, in plain sight, there was nothing really except when you look, if someone knew and they looked very closely, because we'll show you, there are certain clues in my manuscript that tell you.
Little cookie crumbs scattered throughout there to help you out. So excellent. Okay. You arrived in Moscow, and then you made your way to Georgia, which again, a little bit of a distorted map here, but it's quite a distance. You weren't just walking down there. You didn't hop in a pre-Uber to get there. How did you know who you were looking for, who you were meeting, where you were meeting? How was that communicated?
So we had studied beforehand, and we knew the addresses of the people in the Phantom Orchestra, and the lead people were names were Esai Goldstein, the Goldstein family. And in order to get there, we had to just follow directions, which meant we had to get on a subway, then we had to walk, and we had to find the right building, and you know, all of that. Which in hindsight, I think about it now, it's like, oh my God, how did we do that? It worked. We actually, you know, found them along the way, because we were, you know, a little bit, I guess we stood out a little bit.
Just a little.
Some people came up to us while we were trying to find the apartment, and, you know, we didn't know if we should trust them or not.
Yeah.
But ultimately, we had a couple of things we said, and it indicated to us that we could trust them, and we ultimately found the, you know, this first contact, the Goldstein family.
Okay. So, Phantom Orchestra, you've mentioned them several times. Who, again, is part of that? What's the lineage of that? How do people become involved with that?
Yeah, so this is so interesting. So back in 1985, there was a lot of crackdowns in the Soviet Union. People were trying to leave. People were human rights activists. You know, there were people who just wanted freedom, religious freedom, regular freedom, democracy. And in order to feel empowered, this group of people got together, and they got together by playing music. So for the Soviets, this was a real threat, because normally Jewish refuseniks would stay together, Catholic refuseniks would stay together, Helsinki monitors would stay together, poets would stay together. But the fact that they were mingling together was something really special, and folks in the West knew that. And so that's why they wanted us to go in, meet them, support them. And I will say that an amazing amount of bravery and not on our part.
Very much on your part.
Maybe a little
bit on our part. Very much on your part, but yes.
But for them, because to be able to stand up for human rights in a situation where you're going to be arrested, you're going to be imprisoned, you're going to be beaten, which all of these people had already happened to them, it takes such courage. But the music is something that bonded them together, and we'll talk a little bit more about that.
Which I definitely want to explore that. Yeah. So let me share with you some pictures of some of these people, so that you have an image in your mind, and if you can kind of share with us who these people are, how you came to be with them. I see a beautiful, smiling, radiant person right in the middle. But tell us about these people.
Yeah. So on the right. You're right. Is Hankus and Jeff. Those are the two of the musicians that I went with. Rosalie's not in this picture. The rest are the Goldstein family, and Malka is the old woman down on the left. And then the two brothers, the Goldstein brothers, and another friend of theirs and a wife. And they were the first people that we met when we were there, and you can see they put out this amazing spread for us as well.
Amazing.
And I should say, like the Goldsteins, and you're going to see the Godavas in another picture, were, you know, engineers, doctors, but relegated to running elevators or working, you know, from midnight to 8 in a factory because of their outspoken activism.
Got it. Okay. This next one I love.
Yep, that's one of the Godava brothers and his girlfriend. So this is part of, and Phantom Orchestra, I should say, it wasn't really an orchestra. It was more like a ragtag group of people playing guitars and violin and singing and piano.
So whatever instrument you showed up with, your recorder, your harmonica, your I'm going to play percussion, you're allowed.
Exactly.
Okay, excellent. Okay, tell me about these people.
Yep, this is Maestro Simmin. He was a lead violinist, in fact, from the Ukraine, but living in Georgia, and his wife and his kids. And he was an amazing, amazing musician. By the way, you can see a line through these. I shouldn't have had these photos when I came back.
So how did you have these photos when you came back? Yeah, you didn't, we won't jump to the end of the story yet, but you didn't leave on great terms.
That's true. And when we left, all of our film was confiscated, but then handed back to us, and we assumed it was all erased, but it wasn't. So it's kind of a...
It's a gift.
Yeah.
It's a gift to have this with us. Okay, so I do want to explore music. I do want to explore the power of music as a bonding thread of humanity that we all have. And that was something you and I, as we talked music and we talked music and we talked music, and it was, there's a universal language. You did not speak the same tongue as all of these people. I don't even know if all of them spoke the same tongue, but what is it about music that is such a unifying universal language?
Yeah, so we did communicate with some English. Some people knew English, but music was our main communication. I would say we also had a fair amount of vodka. So I would say those three worked. But here's the thing that's most important to me is before I met the people in the Phantom Orchestra, I understood the power of music, right? Because I'm a musician, I play. When I play, I get into a different space, and you would never, ever, you know... It's if you play music, you get it. When we played with the Phantom Orchestra, the power of our playing together and the freedom in our brains was something that I'll never forget. It has become a part of me. So the music is absolutely, going along with your theme, transformative, you know? And going with last year's theme, such resilience in people. But while we're playing, I understood you can be imprisoned, you can be put wherever, and ultimately we were interrogated many more times and put under arrest. In your brain, you can still feel free. And I hadn't understood that power of music until then. That was really remarkable. And just a grounding for everybody. And so I really understood that, and that was something that really I think I take forward with me as well.
Yeah. So you shared that many of these people had been subjected to physical abuse, mm-hmm. psychological abuse,
yep.
emotional abuse. There's all of them brought baggage into this situation. You all sit down together, you play some music. Mm-hmm. You're transported to a different place.
Absolutely, 100%.
There's some parallels between other moments in history with where music has taken people, with what music has, how music has healed people. Within our industry, it's tough. There's some hard times. Cybersecurity, we're constantly getting pounded. Something, you know, you were under attack for this. This is happening here. We need to be taken, transformed, put in a place. What does music offer us?
Yeah, I was thinking about that. I think a couple of things. You know, music is used in many situations. So like during the civil rights era, people would sing as they were put in the back of paddy wagons in order to take the space. Music is used as a way to center and ground yourself. The act and the discipline of practicing music enables you to listen better. And, you know, Chuck and I were talking last night. A lot of what you do, from my understanding, is really dealing with people and understanding people and how they make decisions they do, problem solving, right? And the arts, music, but also visual arts, teach you how to solve problems, how to work well with each other, in music, listen better. Medical doctors, like almost every medical school at this point, requires their doctor, pre-doctors, to take art classes because it hones in their ability to see better. And so I think the arts, you know, as a grounding mechanism, as a flexibility mechanism, as a way to find space when you're dealing with bad guys and bad things, you know, gives you that energy inside your brain. I think maybe those are some things that could apply.
Excellent. And I know, I mean, you're currently a professor of music at a UC. What are you trying to instill within your students who are taking and using music, using the arts to transform throughout society?
I think one of the biggest things that I care about is empathy, and that music and the arts give us a direct road into being empathetic and understanding each other.
Do you think some of that was formed through your experience in the Soviet Union, through the experience that you had with these humans that were going through really difficult, hard situation, and you were able to leave?
Yes.
Ultimately, it wasn't, you left earlier than what your original plan had been, but you were able to leave. You came back to a place that you recognized, where you had freedoms. Do you think that core base of empathy was formed when you were there?
You know, I probably had, you know, this much, but after being there, I would say, you know, it became something that was absolutely fundamental to who I am and how I think about the arts with people in general.
Yeah. So
yes,
transformative to your development at the time. So let's go back to Georgia. You're communicating with people via music.
Mm-hmm.
Let's jump into some of your coding. Musicians in the room and non-musicians alike, I think you're going to see some things in here. There is some regular English, and when I practice with my girls when they're singing songs, I scribble all over, you know, slow down, speed up. There's notations to my. I do not write orange, stop, end, cross, walking left, or a little trash can. What am I seeing here?
Yeah, it might have been me being a little bit lazy, not writing everything out, and but you're seeing directions to get to one of the apartments. And so we knew we had to go on the orange line and stop at the end. We had to cross the street. That's the name of the street.
And then you needed to F sharp, G, F sharp, E, E, G.
Exactly.
Half note. Something important happened in that second measure down there. So, okay.
Exactly. And then the on the bottom line, I couldn't figure out a way to write it out, so I actually drew where the apartment was in the building.
Excellent.
That's what that is. There's a little tiny square in the top square, and that was where the apartment was.
So it's on the second floor. You had to go through some bars across a door, looks
yeah.
like. Okay. So clearly, some of your music came with you written in a book.
Mm-hmm.
Some of your music was composed during your course of the time there. How much of the music was there in place? How much furious composition were you creating as you went? Were those in your group sharing this musical book back and forth, or did you each have your own musical book?
I was the only one that had the manuscript. However, I taught everybody the code.
Okay.
And so when we were there, there were things that people asked us to bring out. So in order to leave the Soviet Union in 1985, you had to be invited and to go to another country. But in order to be invited, you had to have a relative, you had to have, you know, lots of paperwork, including a name, your birth, where, all of that. So there were a couple of people that wanted to be invited, and so we coded all of their information in order to bring that out so that they could receive an invitation. And in a couple of instances, we also coded some stories of people.
Got it.
That they wanted to get out as well.
So those beautiful people that we were seeing pictures of earlier, you're getting their stories, you're taking their information,
mm-hmm.
you crossed left, went in a building, created a song about them. This song actually, I think, is called Mono Man, right? No, Meno Moso Newman Kosh. That's the name of this song that you're seeing right here. Is that a person?
Yeah, that was actually a new person in Moscow who happened to be kosher.
Okay, new person, got it. Okay, so that was the inspiration for the title of your
yes.
song there. Excellent, okay. So we're now gonna go on another journey. We're continuing on to Armenia. As a tourist, what happened when you hit the ground?
Yeah, so in Georgia, after we had played with the Phantom Orchestra quite a lot, well, meaning 3 days, we were interrogated again and again. So we had that. And they at that point, they told us they couldn't guarantee our safety. Okay. But I will also say that members of the Phantom Orchestra took us, we had one last little excursion with them, and it was raining. And I just remember like running with them and singing in the rain. And there's like this beautiful sense of humanity.
Oh, that's awesome.
Is like,
were there puddles? Could you jump in it?
Yeah.
With your yellow slicker? Okay, I can see it.
Then we get on the plane in Georgia. And who's in the back seat of the airplane? Kevin. From our interrogations in Moscow. We know we're in a little bit more trouble now. We land in Yerevan, and we think, you know, we're going to be, we didn't know what to think. And in fact, they put us from the plane into two different cars. Rosalie and I were in one car, and Hankus and Jeff were in another car. And they didn't tell us everything, anything. They just
started. You didn't know if you're going to the same place. You did, at least you got a buddy, but you don't know if both cars are headed
correct.
To the same destination.
They put us in the cars. They start driving us. We have no idea where we're going. And Kevin isn't with us. You know,
Kevin is Kevin in the other car? Or Kevin's in a third car?
In a third car.
Oh, dear. Kevin is in the, okay, Kevin's in the vicinity.
And they just took us to the hotel, which was crazy. At which point, so, you know, there's a lot of mind kind of games going on here, but that we had to deal with in the moment. But we all thought, what the heck? You know, they brought us to the hotel. We want to meet people.
It's a free ride. Free ride to our hotel.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're going to go meet people now, even though Kevin is still following along.
Exactly.
Okay, excellent.
So we go and we make contact with people in Yerevan. We go to an apartment and we say we play klezmer music. And these people were so excited. They came into, they said, we know klezmer music. And they had a tape, you know, like cassette tape.
Uh-huh. I remember those.
Yes. And it was of my band.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
And so we were like, we know klezmer music. Look, we have this tape. And we said, you know, the four of us said, that is us. Oh. And so we had an amazing time playing in Yerevan. We met with people, get back to the hotel. We're told we're under arrest, but the hotel people in Yerevan had no love lost for the KGB. And so they essentially look the other way. We go out, we play. Now, in the meantime, and I know we're getting to this question as well, the people in the Phantom Orchestra knew that we were in a little bit more trouble than we probably knew ourselves. And they contacted Reuters to let them know.
Okay, let's go there.
Ah. There it is.
I wish I had a big New York Times banner here. Don't have that. But the big takeaway is four Americans expelled after Soviet meeting. What happened?
Yeah, so in Yerevan, you know, ultimately after we had played, poor Kevin, who ended up being drunk, as I remember, meets us in the hotel lobby, gives us each a little baggie, I don't think I told you this, with a tea bag, a hard-boiled egg, a piece of salami.
So it's your party favor.
Yeah, our party favor. And it tells us we're going to be expelled to Beirut. We weren't expelled to Beirut. But you can imagine four young Jewish people thinking you're going to be expelled to Beirut.
Yeah.
Ultimately, they brought us back up to Moscow. And by the way, Kevin says
did Kevin
to
come
us,
with you?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Kevin
okay.
says to us, I'm sorry, but one of you has to sit next to me. And so
rock, scissors, paper?
Yes.
Okay.
I lost.
Oh.
So I sat next to Kevin, who turned out to be quite a sympathetic character and told me he learned his English from watching confiscated videotapes, including Porky's. And believe it or not, and if it was up to him, he would let everybody go.
Okay, so maybe Kevin's how your film made it back with you. But if there had been words to it, you might not have gotten it back because Kevin would have learned English from it. I don't know.
You know, I never thought of it, but that might be the thing. Well, so they bring us back up to Moscow. And by that time, we didn't know it, but the U.S. Embassy people were trying to find us, the State Department, because of the...
We're 7 days into a trip, a vacation at this point, 10 days. What time span has transpired? Okay.
Yeah. So when we get back to Moscow, they put us in cars again, separate us, and start driving us around for hours and hours and hours, ultimately landing in a dormitory kind of situation with armed guards. This is where...
You did something kind of naughty at this point. There's a theme going on here. So what happened at this point, Merryl?
We took the advice of the Phantom Orchestra folks that said, if you are put under arrest, and clearly they thought, you know, in hindsight,
that's where you
would
headed.
Be, think about all the people who have been before you, play music together, and somehow retain, you know, a sense.
Create that human bond again.
Yeah. And then we decided... This is so awful in a way.
In retrospect.
We played, because we had guards, we played a beloved Russian folk tune.
Like I played your song over there.
Out of tune.
Oh, excellent. Fourth grade recorder parents. Here we go. Okay.
It somehow made us.
And did they appreciate that?
I never told us.
Okay. Okay. So. Amazing people you helped along the way. There was one person in particular that I wanted to, because this changed the course of history, arguably, a single individual that you helped.
Right, so the person there in the middle, so second to the right, third to the left, his name is Vyad Gamsakhourya. He was the first democratically elected president of Georgia. Of course, we had no idea back at the time, you know, that, you know, the extent to which he was an activist and politician. He was a poet and a writer. And so here you go. I mean, these people were really enormously courageous and brave and willing to fight for democracy.
So, for an extended period of time.
Yes.
I'm going to ask you a final question, and then I'm going to invite additional questions from the audience. We've got a little bit of time for Q&A, and then we're going to leave you with something special. But as you look at what's happening in the Ukraine right now, there's a long shadow of the Cold War that is maybe bringing some different emotions, some different things to mind. What's in your heart and your head?
Yeah, I really admire the musicians and the activists who are in Ukraine, who stay, you know, like Denise, who's the cellist you've seen.
The little girl singing in the subway.
Yes, they are absolutely doing what feels right for them, and I understand it. Whereas, you know, I think a lot of people would say, why aren't they just leaving? You know, I understand why they're staying. I understand it 100%. I also think about Brittany Griner, you know, in prison in Russia. And I, you know, sports for me are very much like the arts.
Absolutely.
And
the performers.
In fact, I have 10 years of boxing under my, believe it or not.
Part two of the keynote.
Yeah, maybe that would have been good way back in 1985. But I think about her and I think, I hope that she, and I suspect she does have the skills to keep her brain free, even though she's
not.
Because that makes such a difference. It really does, and that skill is so important to have. So I really think about what's going on and how people are coping.
Yeah, yeah, excellent. Okay, any questions that you all have for Dr. Goldberg?
I think everyone's just
They're awesome stories, aren't they? You want to hear something else naughty that she's done that's going to come out? Or do you want to go to the final moment where we're going to leave you with some music? We're going to leave, and you already heard the walk-on music. You're famous across Soviet Union. Everyone had your tape. Everyone had your everything. Let's go there. Okay. So I did want to say, well, I wanted to say thank you to all of you for being here. But I want to say, I know for me personally, when I was growing up, my mom called the piano the Britta barometer. She knew, oh, we have a question. Excellent. We're going to in a minute. The Britta barometer. My mom could tell what kind of day that I had had by what I was playing, how I was playing it, how long I was playing it. Music and that outlet is such an important thing to have in our lives. So we're gonna test the Britta barometer in a moment. But thank you, sir. Question.
Yes. Thank you for the presentation. It's fascinating. The question I have is, you said you were going there to support them. Were you taking information, or was the point to get the information out so that you could create the invitation for them to leave their country? Or can you share a little bit about kind of what the mission actually was, other than just meeting them?
Yeah. So back at that time, if people were coming in to visit with refuseniks and dissidents and Helsinki monitors, it provided them some protection. So, you know, it was harder for the Soviets to crack down on them if people in the West knew about them. And so a group called Action for Soviet Jewry, but also Amnesty International, some activist groups had heard about this Phantom Orchestra, but not many people had gone in. And I think Tbilisi is slightly off the beaten track. And so that's when some people in Boston had the idea, maybe we should go in and support them, but also find out if there was information that should come out as well. One of the hardest things for us in this whole story was we knew going in that people would be in jeopardy from our visit. And we would say to them, you know, they already know about us. We're being followed. So many people followed us, by the way, that we would call them carols for the Carol King song, You've Got a Friend. You know, I've got a carol, you've got a carol, there's a carol, there's another carol. We'd have lots of carols.
Are those Kevin carols or Carol carols? Those are admirers of you, or?
No, people following us.
Okay, so these are Kevins and Carols together.
Yes,
okay.
Exactly. Oh, okay. We also knew that people, that our rooms were bugged. At one point, our sink didn't work, and we said out loud, our sink doesn't work, and someone came right up and fixed it. So we had ways of communicating by doing different things. But the point was is that we would tell people that, you know, we're being followed. We don't want you to be in jeopardy. And at every juncture, they would say to us, no, it's more important that you're here and that people know about us. This is what is important. And, you know, it was a really tough pill to take afterwards when we were deported. And we knew people had been arrested and beaten up. And, you know, living with that was really rough. But it also ultimately, you know, most of the folks ended up emigrating, which is really good. But that what they had to put up with in order to emigrate was really something.
One more question.
Do you think it would be possible to make sort of a musical encryption device, like maybe a player piano with a keyboard and mouse?
I think anything's possible. I really do. And this is... I don't know if this answers that question, but there are scientists at MIT, and I find this fascinating. They use music as a way to understand spider silk. So they code like the spider silk, and then they play it back orally, which is not what we did. You know, I used it as an alphabet, really. But they can hear in the music how the silk is made. So I think there's like a lot of possibilities for music and, you know, coding or lots of different kinds of ways to understand other things in addition to the human part.
Awesome. Okay. So I've got another song for you to take you out, but I want you to join me.
I think I can do that.
Awesome. Okay. Got a song for you here.
When's the last time RSA had a soprano sax?
Right? You guys have earned this. 3 days in. It's the best. We're going to going to follow some music. I'm starting D.
Yeah, so Britta doesn't know what I'm going to play at first. So
I just follow her eye. Her eye tells me where to go, and it takes me along. I'm transformed along with you.
Yeah, so
we're starting
play,
in D.
Yeah, and Britta's just going to kind of go like this. I'm going to play what's called a doina, which is completely improvised. So I don't know what I'm going to play either.
And I don't know where I'm going either, so where we go.
And then we're going to go into a tune called Bruggestanz, which means angry dance. It's a dance.
So you can get up and dance along if you'd like. Is that
absolutely
where you're taking us? Okay.
Get up and dance.
Don't throw anything.
Correct. Especially at us.
Okay.
All right, here we go. Give me a little.
For joining one more time for Dr. Merryl Goldberg.
Thank you, thank you. Way to go, Britta.
Enjoy the rest of RSA conference. Thank you again for being here with us this week.